Ka-choo! Let's go 3D. Never mind. Footage meant to be added, did I tell you? What does that even mean? Really? I've never heard anybody say that. It's common knowledge in the TV world, I guess, yeah. You got any idea what a snooze cruise it'd be to watch a magic show without editing? A magic show like that one, anyway. That was ice cold. Anyway, editing is what TV is what makes TV worth watching. Scenes are spliced together, and long or boring scenes are cut out. What was so boring about that? Are you saying you thought there were boring scenes in Miss Wright's magic show? You gotta ask? That script and presentation deserve a place in the cutting room floor. Broadcasting a mess as in... that mess as is would have been a complete disaster. That's why I had to edit the footage. It's just what a TV man does. What didn't you like about the show, exactly? The whole thing. It was a major snooze fest. Maybe common folk like you don't get it. But a show's only good as how loud, flashy, and trashy it is. It was plenty loud and flashy on its own. All you did was add the trash. I suppose each industry has its own way of doing things. Just as we in the legal profession focus on exclusively on evidence and testimony. Exactly! Whether it's showbiz or the legal biz, we do what we gotta do and get to get the job done. Anyway, editing footage is just a matter of course, just a matter of course in the TV industry. All the stations edit footage this way. It wasn't like it was done maliciously or something. It wasn't done maliciously, huh? But I get the distinct impression that you bear feelings of ill will toward Troop Grammary. Huh? What makes you think that? The things that you yourself have said. You'll see, I'll dig up the dirt and expose the dark heart behind that sweet smile. I'll prove those Grammary magicians are all a bunch of lowlives. I also get the impression that you felt this way for a long time.
Objection!
Words such as those can be interpreted in many different ways. For example, though I bear the defense no ill will, I would not hesitate to say that he is a good-for-nothing lout of a lawyer. You bear me no ill will? You could have fooled me. And yet, it is the truth. I am only strict on you, as it seems you have strayed from the path. If you have any objections, Mr. Justice, please make your case with evidence in the future. Mr. Reynolds, please continue your testimony.
Dun dun.
It was a coincidence that particular scene was cut. It wasn't intentional. Of all the scenes you could have cut, why the sword switching trick? That just seems too much of a coincidence to me. Oh, so now you're gonna tell me how I'm supposed to edit my programs, big shot? It's hard being the boss, kid. You gotta make the tough choices, like which content gets cut. Then let me ask you this. Why exactly did you make such a tough choice in this case? You wouldn't understand, champ. It's all about artistic vision. I tell ya, people tell ya how to do your job when they don't know the first thing about it. I may not know TV, but I know evidence law. And boy, do I have some for you, champ. I might not be able to show you that your selective editing was intentional. However, I know you bear to defend an ill will, and this is the evidence that proves it.
Hey! I didn't agree to this! All I did was press!
Well, give me a second here. There, that'll be the shadow. It'll probably be like his cape or something, I don't know. Okay.
first party will pay all expenses for the magic show. The second party will confer all program broadcasting rights to the first party. Article 2. If, through the fault of the second party, the show must be canceled in part or in full, the second party will pay $3 million as compensation to the first party. I don't think that proves that they have ill will, though. Can I back off? Can I back out? I'm gonna save, I guess. I don't know. This seems to be like the most logical thing. Like, oh, you were gonna prank them horribly. Like, buddy. Son of a bitch. That thing? What could that possibly prove? But take a good look right here. Wouldn't you agree that it puts you in a bad light? Actually, it kind of does, though, but looking bad and having evil intentions are two entirely different things. Look at me, for example. I'm not evil, but I am a bit of a bad boy. Oh, if I could be a bad boy myself. But bad lawyers are just get penalties for presenting bad evidence. Yeah, that was my bad. Look, I didn't mean anything by it. It was just a coincidence. I edited out that scene. Just coincidence that particular scene was cut. It wasn't intentional.
Hold it!
Yeah, I'd like to have pressed this first. What other scenes did you cut from the footage? Huh? No others, I guess. You mean you only edited out the sword-switching scene and nothing else? Don't you think it's too much of a stretch to claim that it's just that as mere coincidence? No matter how artificial you find the affair, strange things have happened on their own. Stranger things. That is, unless you have something with which to prove otherwise, defense. Well, if you have a valid criticism of Mr. Wheaton's testimony, feel free to counter with evidence. Well, Apollo? It would sure make things easier if we had some. Oops. I think the defense team needs to be edited out of this trial. That's what they need. I'll have to clean up this footage later. He isn't really gonna put this on TV, is he? Trying to prove malicious intent is tough. All he has to do is say what all it was a coincidence. We need to find some kind of foothold if we want to make any progress. True, but this guy doesn't seem like the type to slip up. So we'll just have to get the information out of him bit by bit. Okay, so it's gotta be that one thing, but I don't know. The only other thing I can think of, it's got to be either that, the clipboard, it's either got to be that or the clipboard, the contract or the clipboard. This will probably be faster than going through the whole text thing anyway. Shit. Let's go. Okay. Well, hang on. Okay, wait. It was also instrumental in the ratings for Rajah's dishonest dealings. Do I do that or the contract? I feel like this is only going to come up when we want to do... Well, I guess it could be for either, really.
Okay, so it's the clipboard then.
Take that!
Huh? What's that you got there? Oh, so you're gonna start with the contract. That's what I just presented a few seconds ago. This is the contract you had Miss Wright sign just before this magic show. This contract between the first party, Take Two TV, and the second party, Miss Wright, reads, if, through the fault of the second party, the show must be canceled in part or in full, the second party will pay $3 million as compensation to the first party.
$3 million? That's a completely unreasonable sum.
I couldn't agree more. And of course, Miss Wright doesn't have that kind of money. Nevertheless, Roger Breeden's had her sign this unreasonable contract anyway. Or more accurately, he conned her into signing it.
Conned her? How did he do that?
There's a trick to the clipboard that was used by Miss Wright to sign her contract. It houses carbon paper that can secretly copy her signature onto the other documents. Oh, come on now, that's quite a nasty accusation you're slinging my way. For starters, you don't have any proof I had anything to do with that carbon paper stuff. Just because Trucy and her agency can't pay up, that doesn't mean I conned her.
But $3 million, that's totally out of reach for the average person. In any case, this is an important new information. Please add it to your testimony, Mr. Brittens.
Where's your proof linking me to that tricked out clipboard? You don't have any, do you? I think I do. Gotta be this, right? Either this or this. But this doesn't have Rettons on it, does it? Oh well, maybe. It's either this or
that. Objection!
Fuck! Sorry, Apollo. Fucked up. Damn it. This trial is a fucking mess. Whoa, hang on. Let me press it first, just in case. This clipboard is yours, though, isn't it, Mr. Rettons?
Well, it belongs to the TV station anyway, that much I know. Maybe it was an old prop from one of our TV shows that got used by mistake.
Or maybe you used it on purpose to con Miss Wright. Mr. Rettons has already stated that he did not. Mr. Justice, please do not use this trial to try and get out of paying your agency's debt. That's not what I'm doing. Proof Mr. Rettons is connected to the carbon paper, huh? If Trucy's signature was copied onto that fake contract, then there must be an original contract that Trucy did actually sign. True, but I bet Mr. Rettons is too savvy to leave something like that behind as evidence. But what if her signature was copied onto more than just the fake contract? Like if I know! We could have proved this way before now, and hey, is this the fourth testimony? Did I get that kind of exactly right? Maybe it's the third. Thought maybe be like, hey, if you fucked up the show, you know, with this prank, then, you know, you would have gotten $3 million. Why would you, you know, whatever. This, I guess, this makes sense too. You must be quite the con man if you can fool a magician with a simple trick. But if you think you can con a lawyer, you're very much mistaken. Hey kid, would it kill you to enunciate in front of the camera? You know, like a newscaster? I'd like you to take a look at Miss Wright's signature here on this note. Now let's compare that signature to the one here on this contract. Well,
would you look at that? They're exactly the same.
That's right, Your Honor. Not just similar, but exactly the same. Nobody can sign their name in the exact same way twice, unless it's a copy. These signatures are proof positive that you conned Miss Wright. And they definitely prove your malicious intent.
Say, not bad, lawyer. I didn't know you had it in ya.
This is really getting interesting now. It'll get great ratings for sure. Don't try and dodge the issue, Mr. Wheatons. The fact that you bear ill will against my client. So the show footage was definitely edited with malicious intent, isn't that right? What a forced argument, defense. All you have really proven is not his ill will toward Miss Wright, but his pecuniary greed?
That's right, I just wanted money, baby. Fat stacks of cheddar, that's all. After all, I'd never even crossed paths with Trucy before this magic show. So I'd absolutely no reason to bear her any ill will, right?
You didn't bear her any ill will, huh? Fat chance. This guy definitely has some major hate for Trucy. See, I'll dig up the dirt and I know we've heard it before. Can't prove it with anything, but the things he said all point to the fact. There must be something between the two of them that gave birth to this grudge. Some sort of connection that not even Trucy is aware of.
Your Honor, I'd like to argue that Roger Rettins and Trucy Wright must have crossed paths before. There must be some hidden connection between them.
Hidden? Connection? What is it now?
Just what are you getting at, Mr. Justice?
It is futile to even ask, Your Honor. Surely it is just another one of the defense's feckless claims.
Objection!
You don't seem to have a very high opinion of me, but once you hear my argument, you'll wish you'd taken me a whole lot more seriously. Will I really? Very well then. Do proceed. Did you figure something out, Apollo?
Nope.
Bluff it. Nope, not a thing. What? That was just some good old-fashioned bluffing, courtesy of Mr. Wright's fine training. Hope you know what you're doing.
If you're going to make such a bold claim, Mr. Justice, I hope you're ready to elaborate.
Ooh, what is this hidden connection between the defendant and Roger? He's Trucy's biggest fan, they're dating, Rettins is a magician too. I can't resist. I can't resist saying this. Don't even like to imagine this, but it could be possible the two of them are dating? If Mr. Rettins and Miss Wright were in a relationship.
Oh, that's good. Yes! Viewers love a secret romance to dish about.
Yes, Trucy and I love each other so much. She's gonna introduce me to her father sometime real soon. Trucy would never fall for a guy like you, and I'm not in a million years.
Mr. Justice, are you aware you're objecting to your own argument?
I'm sorry, Your Honor, but when I saw Mr. Renton's antics, I just had to speak out.
Personally, I can't say that I blame you for wanting to do that. But you're the one who came up with such a disturbing idea in the first place.
Kinda hoping for Trucy to say something. What was I even thinking? All I ended up doing was grossing everyone out. Now, why don't you try again, Mr. Justice? Okay. I thought Trucy was gonna say something, to be honest. I don't know why she didn't. Okay, but I want my badge back. And you know what? just for the last little bit, we're gonna unwind and wear some alternate costumes. And Athena? Eh, why not? Nah, no, it looks stupid. There we go. Just use it as a chance to just do something different. Let's continue. Let's go. Okay. That slide of the hand trick Mr. Rittens did during the recess earlier. Blah blah blah, we know, blah blah blah. Huh? Felting? Yeah, I know. Yeah, we got it, we've seen this. We're looking pretty cool in this outfit though. What if Mr. Rittens is a magician too?
What if? I believe it's up to the defense to fill in the blanks, not me.
Well, if he is, he may have had some contract with Miss Wright somewhere along the way. Your argument is hardly worth responding to. But by all means, please do continue. As a passage in the sacred scriptures of Quranism states, he who gives a sermon to a monkey is himself a monkey. Yeah, it doesn't matter what you say to a dimwit, he ain't gonna get it anyway.
But we saw Mr. Rittens perform a magic trick.
Okay, I'm admiring the outfit. He made his video camera disappear in the blink of an eye.
Well, I think I could be pretty fun if I were a magician. You must have been seeing things. Want me to introduce you to a good eye doctor?
If a connection as tenuous as that is all it takes, then every magician in this country could potentially bear ill will towards the accused. I guess you're right.
You're not the sharpest knife in the drawer, are you, short stuff?
You would do well to cleanse that putrid mind of yours in the holy waters of Mount Pony Pony. 3 days under frigid waterfall, and even you should rise to the level of a monkey.
Haha, a numbskull for a numbskull.
Well, this numbskull has a thick skin, so there. I think I get what they're driving at. Even if he's a magician, it's not exactly a reason to bear a grudge against Trucy, is it?
Hold on! I can think of one person. One magician who has a reason to bear a grudge against Trucy. Or rather, one magician who has a reason to bear a grudge against Troop Grammary.
Oh?
No way!
Is something wrong, Mr. Justice?
Your Honor, the defense wishes to submit evidence at this time.
I see. And what sort of evidence do you have for us?
Evidence that points to the real killer, the one who had the motive to commit this crime.
What?
And what have you come up with this time, defense?
Trucy Wright is the sole heir to Troop Grammary and its name. This puts her square in the crosshairs of one particular magician.
And this piece of evidence points to that one person with a grudge against Miss Wright.
Give me 1 second, Apollo. Gotta make sure, we don't fuck up,
And who exactly are you naming, Mr. Justice?
13 years ago, the great Mr. Reyes belonged to Troop Grammary. But then, the troop ousted him, and Mr. Reyes vowed to get revenge on them someday. And what better way to accomplish that than through the ruination of their sole heir?
But Mr. Reyes is the victim, Mr. Justice. You've named a dead man as your suspect.
But is he really dead?
What do you mean, is he really dead?
If the fact that Mr. Reyes is the victim is what's throwing you off, then how about we consider this possibility? What if the man who died on that stage yesterday wasn't Mr. Reyes? What? You mean the victim was an imposter?
Not Mr. Reyes? Then what about the real Mr. Reyes?
It would mean the real Mr. Reyes is still alive.
That's absurd!
Mr. Justice, who is the real Mr. Reyes, if not the victim of this case?
It's all coming together now. I finally see the gimmick, the trick to this entire case. Are you gonna have one of those end trial putting together things in a cool way, or did they get rid of that? This should explain everything, Your Honor. The real killer, the one who hated Troop Grammary and wanted to sully its name. The magician lurking in the shadows who set up the fake Mr. Reyes in his stead. The real Mr. Reyes is... I mean...
Take that!
I don't even need to say for this.
But that's...
Yes. Yes, it is. Roger Reddins is the real Mr. Reyes. Or Reyes.
What? Him?
Objection.
Oh, hallowed red pepper. Your impotent seeds sprout naught but meaningless empty words. You cannot possibly have proof to support such an outlandish theory.
Not a bad idea for a soap opera. But not even diehard fans of the game genre would stick around past this plot pilot. You want proof? Well, I've got proof. I can prove it by your injury. Yeah. Proving that Mr. Reyes in the yesterday's magic show was a fake. And to do that, I just need you to look at this spot on this poster. This is the injury Mr. Reyes sustained while practicing a magic trick 13 years ago. However, the video and the victim shot of himself shows no trace of that injury.
Oh my, you're absolutely right!
Now, Mr. Rittens, what do you suppose we'd find if we took a look at your right forearm? Is there by chance a nasty 13-year-old scar under that sleeve of yours? Well, Mr. Rittens, why don't you roll up your sleeve and let the court have a look? Or are you hiding something else up there? Ha ha ha. Come on now, I have nothing up my sleeve. I don't need to hide anything up there, because I require no tricks or gimmicks. You see, my magic is the real deal. Is this what you were hoping to see?
There it is, the scar! Just as I thought.
That's right, I am the Forgotten Magician, abandoned in the dark understage of history. The great Mr. Reyes.
This is totally absurd.
Ho ho ho, how ironic, wouldn't you say? that this odious mark carved into me by Troop Grammary would bring me back into the limelight once more. Strange are the karmic threads before me. If the witness is the real Mr. Reyes, then who was the victim who perished in the magic show? He was but a fan. I met him on one of my programs several years ago. He said he had become a magician out of admiration for the great Mr. Reyes. In confidence, I told him my true identity and let him take on my mantle. And when did this man take over for you? About 2 years ago, I taught him my tricks and even acted as his producer. And so a mere amateur became popular magician overnight. Courtesy of my magic, on the stage we call television. Hope you enjoyed the show. You really had us all fooled. Mr. Rettens, or should I say, Mr. Reyes. In your hatred for Troop Grammary, you killed the victim, Mr. Mystery. And then set up Miss Wright to take the fall, didn't you? You did it just to tarnish the Grammary name. Ho ho ho, I have no idea what you're talking about, lad. I set up the prank, that much is true, but it was simply a harmless joke on Trucy, I assure you. Yet she learned of the plan and made a use of it to commit murder. That is how strongly the criminal elements runs in the blood of these Grammarians. But if it was a secret prank plan that few people knew about, couldn't you have been the one to use it for murder instead? Yikes! Yuck! His head! Just kidding. What the heck was that? Heed my words, lawyer lad, for I fear your grasp on reality is slipping. I do believe I told you that my magic is real. It employs neither tricks nor gimmicks. Enough with the ambiguity. Why don't you make your point already? My alibi is pristine as ever. Wouldn't you agree, Miss Prosecutor Sadmati? Yes, I suppose that is correct. The witness does have a solid alibi. What? Recall defense. That at the time of the magic show, Mr. Rettens was at Take Two TV. A fact that many people can easily attest to. Yeah, that's right. I forgot all about that. Ho ho ho, so what do you think, Your Honor? Would you like me to testify on the matter? Yes, I think you better. Please tell the court more about your alibi. Very well then, on with the show. Are you watching Magnifique Grammary? The time has finally come for my magic to snuff out your precious pedigree. The Grammary line will be no more. Okay, now it's playing the fast one here. I was at the TV station at the time of the Penrose performance. I was busy working on another TV program. I could spare no time for the magic show. Do ask my staff if you doubt my claim. And there it is, a simple and perfect alibi. No tricks, no gimmicks, just the truth. Do you understand now, perhaps? I did not grace the theater with my presence until after the incident. So how could I have committed the murder? His staff did say he was there at the station. So it sure does sound like a rock-solid alibi. But that can't be right. If Mr. Rettens is the killer, he'd have been at the theater. There's gotta be a hole in his story. I assure you there are no holes on Mr. Reyes's stage. No tricks, no gimmicks. True magic doesn't need trapdoors and escape through. Do enjoy my show to the fullest. And my real alibi. I'm trying to think maybe if the footage happened before he killed him, like way in advance, but... Well, no, he had to be there in order for his part in the show, so never mind. But you did come to the theater eventually, isn't that right? Indeed, anxious to see how the show was progressing, I made my way to the theater. Let's see, my journey took about 10 minutes by car. Kuruma de jupun gurai desu. Anyway, 10 minutes by car, that's what I just said. Could he actually have been at the theater during those 10 minutes, killing the victim? Ho ho ho, allow me a stab at reading your mind. Aha! Could I have been at the theater during those 10 minutes, killing the victim? How in the... But no, I took a taxi. The driver can attest to that. Feel free to call the taxi company if you, my word does not satisfy you. The driver is a big fan of the reigning's Raja. I even gave him my card. He gave the driver his card. That was very clever of him. You might as well give it up, lad. Questioning the real magic is a fool's errand. Or errand. Besides, you know very well that I was doing what I was doing at the time of the incident. Busy working on another TV program. I can spare no time for the magic show. What was this other TV show you were working on? My own special project, you see? One moment. Perhaps this is more appropriate. It's a Ratings Raja special production! Yeah! Hang loose, baby! It's called Desperation Renegation. He switched personas just to say that. What's the show about? Washed up has-been singers and comedians get together and play musical chairs. The winner of the game is given a second chance at their career. A priceless prize for chumps who washed up too early in life. Sounds great, right? Might I suggest you appear on that show, Mr. Justice? As an ex-lawyer who used to make ridiculous bluffs in court and faded sadly into obscurity. And let the Ratings Raja produce my TV debut? Not in this lifetime. You have great reactions. Who knows? TV might be your true calling. Hey, whose side are you on? In any case, I was overseeing production of this program during the Penrose Theater performance. Do ask my staff if you doubt my claim.
Hold it!
How do we know those staff members aren't in cahoots with you? I make it my business to perform solo. My magic has neither need nor want of assistance. After all, more of them could reveal the secrets behind my magic, could they not? So he doesn't trust anybody, huh? He's the complete opposite of Trucy. There were many people in the studio audience who saw the witnesses well. Even if he had been able to persuade his own staff to come before him, he could not have been convinced so many complete strangers to do the same. He really has made a rock-solid alibi for himself. Yeah, it's almost too good, you know? It's eerie how perfect it is. It's all been revealed to you now. Or has it all been revealed to you now? And there it is, a simple and perfect alibi. No tricks, no gimmicks, just the truth.
Hold it!
I've got it! Do you have a brother? A brother that looks exactly like you, maybe? Except his hair kinda looks like a bat? Again with the twins business? You think the audience will let you get away with using the same gimmick twice in a row? If you do not believe in defense, why not investigate for yourself? Though I am sure your efforts will prove to be thoroughly fruitless. Yeah, I guess the twins theory is a little far-fetched. His alibi really is airtight.
I believe we've heard enough. Well, I believe the witness does indeed harbor some ill will against the defendant. There was no reason to doubt that he was at the TV station at the time of the incident.
Yes, the facts prove it was impossible for the witness to have been involved with this crime. These last rites for the victim have dragged on long enough. The soul of the victim himself is so bored that it is resting on top of your honor's forehead, on your honor's head.
It is?
I didn't see. The time has come. Let us punish the sinner and guide the victim's soul to the Twilight Realm. Follow. Trusty will be thrown in prison, and we'll be out of a job. But if you catch... tasty fishies, will you sell me some at a good price? I told you, I have absolutely zero intention of going off on a tuna boat. Wait, what? When did that... Think, Justice, you have to figure this out. It's no use. I can't find a single flaw.
So what now?
Time to bluff. Behold, my never-ending medic show. Come for awe-inspiring showmanship of the great Mr. Grass. And stay for my grand illusion until the end of time.
Wait, is he saying that we're still trapped inside some sort of illusion of his? That's what professional magicians do. They make their audience see something that isn't really there. In other words, you make us see illusion. You make us see illusions, right? We call it misdirection. Well, we keep you busy believing one thing, we're busy making something else happen. What we say is there, it really isn't, and what we say isn't there actually is. Could it be? You know what, Mr. Rettins? I guess we have all been spectators to the elaborate illusion you've prepared for us. An illusion that subtly turned our attention towards something you wanted us to see. What are you going on about, lad? Have you got something, Apollo? I just remembered something Trucy said about misdirection. What a magician says is there really isn't, and what they say isn't there actually is. If we've all been taken for a ride by Mr. Breton's magic, then maybe he's made us see something that wasn't really there. It's time to rethink all of my assumptions about this case. What we have been made to believe was there when it actually wasn't? What have we taken to be the absolute facts of this case? If I reevaluate the validity of all of these things, then just maybe... Oh, is it time? Are we doing this? No. Athena, there's something uncanny about this case. Okay, what is it? Breton's alibi. It's too perfect. That's true. It's like impossible to break, no matter how hard we try. But maybe that's the trick. Maybe that's exactly what he wants us to think. I'm not following. We're not making any headway here because we've been so focused on breaking his alibi. Oh, I think I get it. You're saying he's using misdirection on us, right? It's definitely a possibility. What?
Would the defense care to share with everyone what it's discussing over there?
Your Honor, we believe that if we were to reconsider a certain assumption, we may finally arrive at the truth. In fact, I think we'll even finally see who's hiding behind the curtain, so to speak.
And what is this certain assumption you're thinking of?
This is the one key assumption we've been taking for granted this whole time. His guilt... The culprit was on scene. The crime scene. I think it's this. The culprit was on scene. We assume that he had to be there. And his alibi is so perfect because it actually is perfect. He wasn't there. That's what I'm gonna say. That's what makes the most sense to me. What if the culprit was somewhere other than the theater at the time of the crime? What if there was some way to commit the crime with the murder without actually being there? If that were the case, then Mr. Retton's perfect alibi would become irrelevant. Could one person stab another to death with a sword without physically being there? Furthermore, we all saw what appears to be the culprit's shadow on the stage.
Objection!
But couldn't we just as easily assume that the shadow does not belong to the culprit?
Well, if it's not the culprit's, then whose is it?
Not 100% sure yet, but I'm pretty sure I'm on the right track. We've all seen something that looks like the shadowy shape before, Your Honor. During the magic show itself.
In that case, please point it out in the show footage for us.
This is the thing that looks suspiciously similar to the shadowy figure of the culprit. Ah, fuck. Ah, come back here.
Take that!
Doesn't this shadow resemble the suspicious shadowy figure?
Now that you mention it, it does, doesn't it?
Miss Frank, could you identify this shadow for the court? Let's see, I believe that's Mr. Hat's shadow. It's from when he's being pulled up to the stage to the catwalk overhead by wire. Then could this shadow that's shown in later in the footage be Mr. Hat too? No, that's not possible. Mr. Hat was pulled up to the catwalk, he stayed up there. In other words, this second shadow is from some other figure being pulled up.
Some other figure? I'm afraid you'll need to be more specific than that, Mr. Justice.
He's right. We've come this far. Just have to figure it out from the clues I have on hand.
What is the second shadow shown in the footage?
Before I do this...
Take that!
If we consider what was happening on the stage at the time, there's only one answer. The shadow belonged to the fake Mr. Reyes. In other words, Mr. Manav Mystery.
The victim?
Please take a look at the prank plan script. Mr. Mystery was pretend to be dead and then fly up into the air after that. Isn't that right, Mr. Rettens?
Indeed, and what of it?
I contend that this is exactly what happened. The victim was wearing a stunt harness around his waist. It was most likely attached to a stunt wire so that he could be pulled up into the air.
So you're suggesting that after pretending to be dead on the coffin, the victim flew up into the air just as the prank script says?
Exactly. We just couldn't see him go flying up because the dragon was blocking our view. And that last trick, ladies and gentlemen,
is the true piece de resistance of the culprit's murderous magic show.
Don't tell me. You've got it all figured out?
Yes, I think so. If we can just look beyond Mr. Renton's last bit of misdirection, we should finally be able to see the real truth. The victim must have pulled up to the catwalk just like Mr. Hat. And hit the cushioning up there with considerable force. Just to figure out what else happened up there at that time.
Are you ready to elaborate, Mr. Justice?
Yes, Your Honor, I'm ready.
In that case, please answer this.
Why did the culprit make the victim fly up into the air like that? To falsify an alibi? To murder him? To hide the body? To murder him. Just why did the culprit have the victim fly up after he appeared in the coffin? And how did the victim actually die? When he was only pretending to be dead in the coffin? If we can figure out how these two questions relate, the answer should become clear.
Could it be?
Mr. Mystery, must have thought he was still just part of the prank when he appeared on stage. Probably didn't suspect a thing as he was being pulled into the air. After Miss Wright was called back on backstage, and just as the set piece fell. Or it was just as the set piece fell.
But the culprit had already planted the real murder weapon in the cushion in the catwalk. It was probably a knife or a blade of some sort.
What? You mean... Yes. It really was a magical murder. Just as the prank script said, Mr. Mystery was whisked up into the air. And straight into a blade there in the catwalk. In other words,
this murder was committed remotely through the use of a magic trick.
What?
Remotely?
Using this method, it wouldn't matter where Mr. Brettons was at the time of death.
but how exactly does it work, Mr. Justice?
Just before the murder occurred. The dragon's set piece was up in the catwalk. And Mr. Men of Mystery. It and Mr. Men of Mystery were connected to each other by a wire at the time. By carrying out the prank plan, Betty made the dragon set piece fall, which caused Mr. Mystery to rocket straight up. And into the blade in the cushion! But how did he get down? The cushion was high enough to be hidden from the audience's view. That's why nobody saw the blade. Oh, and that big gash in Mr. Het's cap? The blade must have been set up overhead sometime before the magic show. Mr. Het must have been slashed by a tube when he was pulled up to the cushion. I can't believe it. I had no idea. I was told that Trucy would freak out if I made the set piece fall. That's the only reason I did it. You were used, Betty. Roger Retton's used you. I thought he was my little puppet to boss around, but it was the other way around. After the incident occurred, Mr. Retton's arrived at the theater. He got the murder weapon and swapped the rubber sword with the bloodied steel one. That's also when he lowered the victim's body down onto the stage. But how did he have time to do all that? When the set piece fell, the audience was evacuated from the building. He was able to do all these things after the fact because there was no one around to see.
A horrific murder camouflaged by a spectacular magic show?
But how did he get in?
That sounds like a kind of murder only a magician could pull off.
As long as the show proceeded as it was scripted, Mr. Mystery was doomed to die.
That's why it was you, Mr. Rettons, who killed the victim, all the way from the TV station. This prank plan, or should I say, murder plan, proves your murderous intent.
Shot to them.
Oh, what? Really?
Satora ima o mandomo samashi de tashi no ketare gase yo soroka!
Enough. You dim-witted, ignorant, imbecilic, putrid red pepper.
You can't possibly have a counter-argument tonight. Talk about not knowing when to let it go and move on. Do you have a rebuttal or something, Prosecutor Salpani? No blade of any kind was found in the catwalk. Which means, you have no evidence to support your theory. But Mr. Retton's retrieved it after the fact. Which still leaves you with no way to prove your wildly fantastic remote murder murder theory. But without proof, does it not make more sense to believe that the murder was committed there on stage? That's where the bloodstained sword was found, after all.
That's a very good point.
As the only person who could have committed the crime there on that stage,
Trucy Wright remains the prime suspect.
It would appear that what you call truth is little more than a cheap parlor trick. In the end, you have done nothing to prove the accused innocence. It is time at last to let it go and move on.
Ho 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 ho. Are you seeing this, Magnifique Grammary? My magic is exacting punishment on your granddaughter. The Grammary name is done for.
Paula, we need to hit them with a magic, with a decisive piece of evidence here.
I know, that's just what I was thinking.
Mr. Justice, do you or do you not have anything to prove that the witness committed this remote murder you proposed?
Of course I do, Your Honor.
This entire incident was carried out exactly according to the script.
Right, so that theoretically there should be no evidence for us to find or use. Which means our best bet is to see if something unscripted happened. There's gotta be something Rettons couldn't have foreseen. And once I find it, that's how I'll expose his murderous trick. Get ready, Mr. Rettons, because I'm about to reveal the secret to your magic. There are no tricks or gimmicks here, just some good old-fashioned logic. Here we go. Is it time? Yep. Alright, so they are gonna do this. Alright. As long as the magic show went as scripted, the murder would have happened without fail. Everything in this case was carefully planned so that no evidence would be left behind. Still, one thing happened that definitely wasn't in the plan. What part of the magic show wasn't part of the show's original script? The mistake. I like this. But I liked it better whenever you saw like whoever was doing the thinking. You kind of saw like a very translucent kind of looking picture of their head, and they had their eyes closed and they were in deep thought. I liked that. Bonnie made a mistake during Tracy's escape trick. What mistake did Bonnie make during the trick? Stage lift preparation, her life choices, Mr. Rettons' message. Because Bonnie placed Mr. Hat to the right of the coffin instead of the left, Trucy had to reappear on the stage of the coffin opposite to the one in this show's script. But the culprit didn't know that when he first arrived at the theater, which means he was bound to make a slip-up when he tampered with the crime scene. Which part of the culprit's cover-up attempt was affected by Trucy's new position? Blood in the coffin hole. Fingerprints on the coffin. The edited show footage. Which part of the culprit's cover-up attempt was affected by Trucy's new position? So she appeared on the right of the stage instead of on the left. Blood in the coffin hole. It should have been on the left, right? Because she stabbed from the right? Yeah. And this is where the whole thing that they are interchangeable comes into play. Thinking Tracy had appeared on the left, the culprit must have put the blood in the left hole. But the blood was eventually discovered in the right hole during the police investigation. The killer had originally put the blood on the left side that means. He must have tampered with the scene again afterwards to make it line up with the facts. To make the crime seem inconsistent with the facts, the culprit must have... Right. The left and right panels of the coffin are interchangeable. The culprit must have switched the two panels to make the bloodstain fit the facts. But the switch must have also given rise to something unnatural. Oh, I remember now! There was something unnatural about the coffin, and it's just the evidence I need. Sorry, Mr. Rettons, but I have some very conclusive proof of your guilt. Another bluff, is it? There's no way you have anything of the kind. My magic is real. No, there are tricks and gimmicks to it, just like any other illusion. What? After the murder... You switched the left and right panels of the coffin, didn't you? And because you did, you left behind something very unnatural for us to find. This proves that Roger Rettons tampered with the crime scene after the murder took place. I know what's going on. I gotta find the piece of evidence that says that the fingerprints were... Oh, here it is. The fingerprint results?
What about the fingerprints is unnatural?
Let's take a look at the prints on the victim left inside the coffin, shall we? If the victim was facing
forward in the coffin, his print should look like this. However, what we found was... they were facing the opposite direction. It's quite unnatural for the prince to be facing this way, wouldn't you agree?
It is strange, isn't it? But how did they get this way?
They got this way because the culprit thought the magic show had gone according to the script. The culprit thought Mr. Hat would be on the left side of the coffin. And that Mrs. Wright would also pop up to the left of the coffin as per the show's script. He then assumed she had thrust the sword into the hole on the left side of the coffin. That's why he put blood in the left hole when he was trying to cover up his crime. But sometime after leaving the bloodstain, the culprit must have realized his mistake. He found out that due to Bonnie's mistake, Mr. Hat was on the right of the coffin. And that despite the script, Miss Wright had thrust the sword into the hole on the right. In short, the hole with the blood in it was on the side opposite the one that Trucy used. To make the blood's location fit the facts, he had to tamper with the evidence yet again. So he tried to cover his tracks by switching the coffin's left and right panels.
Oh, and that's how the fingerprints in the coffin ended up backwards. Because the culprit switched the two sides panels around, the prints ended up facing the opposite direction. But instead of going to all that trouble with the panels, why didn't the culprit just wipe the blood away and redo it with on the other side?
I'm afraid that wouldn't have worked, Your Honor. Because a little something called luminol testing.
Oh, right. Luminol. I almost forgot. Luminol can detect trace amounts of blood, even if it's wiped away, right?
That's right. Wiping the blood away would have been only served as a proof of his meddling. How about it, Mr. Brentons? I did a pretty good job figuring out your trick, didn't I?
Trucy Wright could have done the same just as easily. You have no proof that it was the witness who tampered with the evidence.
Ah, but I do have proof.
What?
A person who was in the magic show would never have made the mistake of putting the blood on the wrong side. Least of all, Miss Wright, who surely would have remembered which was on the other side.
Oh my, you're absolutely right!
Why, you impudent.
I'm sure you realize by now, Prosecutor Sadmati, that your claim that Miss Wright is the culprit just doesn't hold up.
You and the accused are most certainly bound for hell.
Really? Miss Wright and I? Because I'd think you're the one with the ticket there for trying to convict an innocent girl.
Oh, rest in shit, Prosecutor Sadmati, are you alright? As for the true culprit,
he is someone who knew how the show was supposed to go but didn't actually see it, and someone who had the chance to tamper with the crime scene after the incident, and the only person who fits the bill is you, Roger Reddins. Grammary! All of the secrets to your tricks have been revealed. And with no tricks left, I'm afraid your show has been cancelled.
Permanently!
All of my secrets have been revealed, you say? Don't make me laugh, boy. Mine is the true, real magic. There are no secrets to reveal. Behold, ladies and gentlemen, the true power of the great Mr. Reyes. Witness a magic far greater than troop gravities. Burn. Crumble. Fell to my furious flames. The great Mr. Reyes. We'll bring an end to you all. now for the final heir to the Grammary name, right here, right now. You too. Huh? No, this isn't right. No, I didn't do anything wrong. No, it's not my fault. I'm not the one to blame. I'm the victim here. What? Curse those Grimmaries. It's all because of them. Even now they wound me. Curse them and all to the abyss. Do you really hate us that much? Does your hatred run that deep? Deep enough to kill an innocent man? You're damn right. You have no idea what humiliations I had to suffer. Grandfather, Magnifique Grammary, kicked me out after I got hurt practicing my magic. He said I was too unskilled, that I would mess up on stage. He threw me out of the troupe just because he was worried about his own reputation. Since I was but a child, it was always my dream to become a great magician. But that Magnifique, he took it all away from me. But that's no excuse. That's no reason to do something so evil. Magic is supposed to make people happy, not used as a means for murder. What's the big deal? I just used what I had available to me, that's all. I get it now. That attitude toward magic is why my grandfather kicked you out. You don't deserve to call yourself a magician. Don't deserve. I don't know about that. After all, you were completely taken in by my magic, weren't you not? If not for that lawyer over there, you would be on your way to prison as we speak. You're right. I didn't see through your tricks. You see? So in the end, Troop Grammary was defeated by the great Mr. Reyes. Ho ho ho. You're not fit to lecture me from on high, Trucy, right? You don't deserve to call yourself a magician, you naive greenhorn. Ha 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 ha. Take that, Grammary. You lose! Anyone needs to learn to let it go and move on, it's this guy. Ha 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 ha. This court and my prison can both burn in the flames of my celebrator's creation.
Bailiff, take Mr. Rittens away. And bring a fire extinguisher just to be safe. Looks like we've reached the end. Feel as though I've been watching a grand magic show.
It was close, but we barely made it through somehow. I actually really like this outfit on Apollo. Huh? Why does Trucy look so down?
Miss Wright?
Yes, Your Honor?
I'm about to announce my verdict. Could I see that wonderful smile of yours? That smile of a true entertainer, as I do?
Yes, Your Honor.
Now then, this court finds the defendant Trucy Wright. Court is adjourned.
April 28th. district got blah blah blah. Thank you for everything, Polly. Oh, Trucy. Now you can open your show tomorrow, just as planned. Yep, and it's all thanks to you two. Oh, but now that Mr. Reyes is gone, I'll need to find somebody to replace him. I don't like the way she's looking at me. Trucy, sorry about everything. Hey, what are you apologizing for? Roger Wheaton's used us, we're victims too. He even made us accomplice to murder. He even made me an accomplice to murder. But Betty, we have to take some of the blame for this too, you know? Even if we didn't know he was planning to kill Mr. Mystery, we did cooperate with him. It's all my fault, isn't it? Neither of you is to blame. The only one in the wrong is the person who used magic to commit murder, Roger Rettins. Rettins. Don't you think I know that? Say what you want, but I don't think for a second that I don't still hate you. I guess she really does hate me. But Betty, why? You used to be a huge fan of Trucy's. Hey, shut up! I always hated her. Really? But if we hadn't seen Trucy's magic show, we never would have tried to become professional magicians ourselves, right? Speak for yourself. But Betty, you still have her autograph from that day. Just shut up. She was acting that way the whole... Was she acting that way the whole time because she secretly loves Trucy? Wow, Trucy, I never knew that being the best could be so tough. Come on, Bonnie, we're leaving. We have to get ready for tomorrow's show. You're really excited about performing with Trucy again, aren't you? That's not true, so zip it, dummy. Polly, do you think I really am a naive greenhorn? Huh? No way, she's not. Why are you listening to what some scumbag said? After all, you were completely taken in by my magic, weren't you not? Blah blah blah. Trucy, don't tell me you're taking what Mr. Rettins said to heart. Well, maybe a little. I didn't see through his tricks, and I let myself be taken in by his magic. I can't trust myself anymore. Maybe he was right to call me a greenhorn. You shouldn't take stock in his words. He doesn't even know the first thing about you. Huh? You're a wonderful grammar magician. You should be proud of yourself. Thank you, Apollo. But what makes you say that? I know you're a wonderful grammar magician because of this.
Take that!
That? Oh, I get it. Thank you, Polly. I appreciate it. Sweet of you to try and cheer me up. Huh? Wait a minute. Did I get it wrong? Emma? Really sorry, Trucy, for everything. But why? Well, I wasn't able to convince Prosecutor Sadmati what a good person you are. I had to testify against you, too. Oh, wait, what the fuck? Hang on! No second chance? Fuck. Well, shit. I would assume that it would be this. But let me just look through.
Take that!
My grandfather's notebook? The Grammarly Creed. True entertainer always keeps a smile on their face.
when you performed your magic trick in court today. You showed the world your dedication to Troop's creed. Even through all the jeering, you kept a smile on your face and won the crowd over. You're everything Magnifique could have hoped for in the air. You're a great magician, Trucy. A great magician? Me? You really are. That's why. You don't have to worry about what Retton said. Oh, Polly. Thank you. Still, I couldn't have done it without you. I would have lost my nerve if I had been alone up there. But I was able to keep on smiling because of you. Me? I remembered what you said when you... To me in the detention center. Come on, my attorney's badge isn't good enough to cheer you up? After all, you're sure you swapped the swords, right? Yes, I remember doing it. Then I just know it wasn't your fault, Trucy. But how can you say that? You don't have any proof it wasn't me. I mean, I know you're a great lawyer, Polly, but I believe in you, Trucy. And I believe in your skill as a professional magician. So I'm going to prove your innocence. Don't worry, you're going to be fine! Your words are what kept me going. Paula, thank you from the bottom of my heart. Now I can be everything I was meant to be. Lucy's real smile is the best. I'm so glad I could make that happen. Emma? I'm really sorry, Trucy, for everything. But why? Well, I wasn't able to convince the prosecutor what a good person you were. And I testify against you, too. You have nothing to apologize for. You were just doing your job. You're too kind. Oh, I don't know about... Huh? Something wrong, Emma? Oh. Oh, hello there. Prosecutor Sadmati. What are you doing here? I have come to kill you, Detective Sky. Yes? I require your forensic expertise in order to close this case. Come, let us go. Wait, Prosecutor Sadmati! The trial is over, Mr. Justice. You and I are strangers once more, with no further need to interact. Strangers? Have you really forgotten all about me? What? You've really changed. Nahyuta telling me to let it go and stuff. What happened to you? A lawyer of impure soul. I have nothing to say to the likes of you. Are you serious? Nahyuta? Now, if you'll excuse me. Wait, did Apollo didn't know him. Why does he say he, like, changed or something? There he goes. What was that all about, Apollo? How do you know Prosecutor Sadmati? Let's just say we're old acquaintances. Wait, what the fuck? Acquaintances? It seemed like something more than that. Yeah, why didn't this come up, like, anywhere before? Yeah, well, you don't like to talk about your past, do you? Because you always change the subject. I guess I'll have to talk about it someday. But for now, come on, let's forget about the past and celebrate Trucy's future. Sure, if you say so. Hey, it's Mr. Wright. Put him on speakerphone, Apollo. What's up, Mr. Wright? Apollo! How's Trucy? What happened to the trial? Did you get a not guilty verdict? Mr. Wright, slow down. Everything's fine. Hi, Daddy. I'm okay now. She was found not guilty in a very dramatic turnabout. Plus, we saved the office. It was a great victory for Apollo. Phew, good. I really didn't think he had it in it. I mean, that's a load off my mind. I can't thank you enough, Apollo. Now I know I can trust you to hold down the fort at any time. Me? Really? Yes, you. You're a real full-fledged lawyer now in my eyes. Full-fledged lawyer? I still can't wrap my mind around it. Thank goodness you were there to take care of everything. And thank you, Apollo. No need to go that far, boss. Especially not in front of everyone. Oh, and by the way, I won't be able to make it to tomorrow's show, so I was hoping you could go. You'll do that for me, won't you? Of course. I wouldn't miss it for the world. Full-fledged. So Daddy asked you to come to tomorrow's show, huh?
as my assistant, right? No. He just asked me to go cheer you on. Okay, then I'll be sure to save you the best seat in the house, Polly. The best seat in the house? I really appreciate the thought, but... Good, then it's settled. Uh-oh. Oh, no. Can this be in a cutscene?
Objection!
I should have known. That this is what she meant! Magical girl Trissy Wright will now perform her greatest illusion yet. There are no tricks or gimmicks here, ladies and gentlemen. This is real magic.
Wait a minute! You're kidding, right? There is a trick or gimmick, right? I'm too young to die.
Now then, Mr. Hat, you know what to do with that sword.
No, wait! Stop! No!
That's how Trucy and Gremory Land ended on a rousing high note, with a big round of applause and Polly's ear-splitting screams. What kind of an ending is that? So that went way longer than I thought it would. And this is the Rite of Tournament. I'm guessing this is Phoenix, or maybe it's a, no, it's not Athena, it's gonna go them, Phoenix. So let's see what we have in store. We'll watch the first cutscene and then we'll stop.
Wakey wakey 201, got some more questions. Sound the alarm! Prisoner 201's escaped!
Well, you know, with Dad's back on the streets, things will be on the up and up for us.
Keep your voice down. You want that rebel hunter to find us or something?
Come on. We're small fries compared to... Huh?
Well, all right, that is what you have to look forward to. You get to see some sort of magic ninja man kill people, or woman, or whoever, I don't know. Oh my god, oh, that went on for so long, okay, so aside from a few hiccups and lies, that trial was all right, it's pretty good. It's just, yeah, god, I didn't expect to sit here so long. But, yeah, so there's maybe only two or three more trials left to go. That was only one investigation and one trial. That's not usually how it goes. At least I'm pretty sure. Yeah, that's not usually how it goes. Oh well. Anyway, yeah, so that was fun. I don't want to make this any longer than it has to be, so yeah, thank you for watching, and I hope you will join me next time. And I'll see you next time.